This is the legendary 1977 KIM-1 computer, the oldest home computer on eBay. This particular example is a rare revision A and is housed in a complete double backplane of expansion boards ranging from text and graphics to disk controllers and EEPROM burners. The only thing it's lacking is a C compiler, and I'm going to solve that today. For the first time in 45 years, the KIM-1 is going to drink code from the fire hose of the CC65 compiler until prime numbers come out its nose. Hey, I'm Dave. Welcome to my shop. I'm Dave Plummer, a retired operating systems engineer from Microsoft, going back to the MS-DOS and Windows 95 days, and today we're going to make a C compiler work for the KIM-1. We're going to port CC65 to the KIM-1 by providing all the code and plumbing needed. I'm going to write a rudimentary HAL, or hardware abstraction layer, for the KIM-1 itself. Then we'll code up a wickedly fast Prime Sieve and test it live on my real KIM-1 hardware. I'm not one of those static collectors. I don't want to just buy old computer equipment to live on a shelf in some static display looking cool. The critical thing to me is that everything works, and perhaps more important, I want the machines to be able to actually do something interesting. Even my old VT220 terminal is used to keep tabs on the build machine that does continual content integration on the Language Racing Primes project. My PET 2001 serves as an accurate 24-hour clock. My TRS-80 Model 1 has been upgraded with Ethernet and serves files on the Internet. As a more complex example, my friend Rutger and I created this spectrum analyzer and audio visualizer for the Commodore 64, writing the whole thing in hand-coded assembly language and then building it with the CL65 Assembler. The CL65 Assembler, however, is just one component in the set of tools that comes with the CC65 compiler, which is a reasonably complete open-source C compiler for the 6502 processor. I became stoked about the idea of being able to use a C compiler to put some modern code on the old KIM-1, but unfortunately, CC65 does not support the KIM-1. Now, it certainly could compile some library code into pure 6502 instructions, but it would have no way to interact with the world or even the machine around it. How would it even know where the RAM was located on the machine? Consider the example of simple printf. In order for that statement to work, it needs to handle text output. Behind the scenes, printf is going to use the file stream for standard out and push the text string out to it, but absent a library implementation of standard out, the compiler has no idea how the underlying I.O. actually works. After all, a KIM-1 that does its I.O. over the serial TTY is very different from a Commodore 64 that displays text on a CRT via a two-dimensional screen editor. And how the C64 handles its text is going to be quite different from how an Atari would do it. Those differences are all accounted for in the standard library implementations, and the CC65 compiler uses the notion of a target. A target is a supported platform variant, and CC65 supports dozens of targets, ranging from the familiar VIC-20 and Atari, and Apple II to the more obscure PC Engine and Lynx. And yet, there's no KIM-1 support. Put simply, nobody has wanted enough to sit down and write it. Until today, that is. So we're going to really have to dig into CC65 to understand how it works, and what I need to do in order to add an entirely new platform or target to the compiler. I'll update the compiler itself with the new KIM-1 target code and then write the assembly code needed for the standard library. Then I'll write a prime number sieve in C to test it out and demo it all for you live. Fortunately for me, somebody named Wayne Parham had already implemented at least one single board computer of the same general era, the SIM-1 trainer. The SIM-1 is like a super KIM-1, adding things like more RAM, EEPROM sockets, and RS-232 ports, and so on. None of that SIM-1 stuff would work directly for me, but it would still be highly valuable for showing me precisely what and where I had to supply code and configuration for the KIM-1. So by standing on the shoulders of the giant that wrote the SIM-1 support, I should be able to see far enough to implement the KIM-1 support. The first thing I need to do then is to fork the CC65 project in GitHub. That would give me a personal copy of the source code that is still linked to the original. And that will allow me to have my changes ultimately propagated back into the original project at some point in the future. Once I have a fork of the code, we can clone it into a local folder. Now, my setup is a little unconventional. I'm running Windows 11, but I'll be using Ubuntu Linux under WSL2 as my command line tool environment, except for building CC65 itself, where I'll be doing that inside of the MinGW environment, since I want to build compiler binaries targeted to run on Windows. For example, here's the configuration file I've just created. This config file format is proprietary and looks a little alien, but after this it's all regular code and headers, so hang in there for a moment. One highly important declaration is the default start address, where our app should be loaded into memory. Because remember, 6502 code uses all kinds of absolute addressing, and it's not relocatable in any way. A program is compiled and assembled to live at a particular address, and that's the only address it will work at. For a non-expanded KIM-1, we can see from the memory map in the system manual that our available memory starts at hex 200, right after the stack and zero page, and that's where we should base and load our apps. For an expanded KIM-1, it's more complicated. I'll need to create a separate configuration file for the expanded 60K edition, but the system riot chips are mapped into memory around 1700 hex, and RAM picks up again at 2000. We would need to define those sections separately, and perhaps we could put the code at 200 and the heap at 2000. Or we could base everything at 2000 and make use of the low memory in some other way. Regardless, we need a configuration file for each and every different KIM-1 configuration. I'll only be supporting two, the unexpanded 1K version and the full ride 60K version. In the memory section, I've put the definitions for the zero page, the stack, the main RAM, and the ROM that my CoreShim.io board has on board. The segments section defines important things like where in memory the code should be loaded. Code goes into a read-only section of memory, even though there's nothing actually to stop you from writing to it unless you then burn it into ROM. Data goes into a read-write area, and zero page is special. Since the KIM-1 itself uses some of the zero page, we put a ceiling on the available addresses at hex EE. That means the compiler will only use addresses 0 through ED. Now that the compiler has some notion of how to generate code for the KIM, we need to implement the very basic core of the C runtime library. That comes down to doing two things, at a minimum, implementing the basic I/O functions and then adding any ROM functions from the KIM-1 itself that we wish to expose. The only ones I'll worry about today are to load and save from tape. I'll implement those as sort of a demo of how to expose machine-specific features. The first step to exposing machine functionality is to create a header file for the assembly language that's defining your symbols. I've created this file, which basically defines all I currently know about the KIM-1 ROM routines. The routine to output a single character to TTY, to read one, and to load and save from tape, and where the addresses and ID information for the tape image live in memory. One language level higher up, we need to define a header file called KIM1.h, and this can be included by any C programs that wish to access KIM1-specific behaviors. As noted, the only two custom examples that we'll be adding are the load and save routines, loadT and dumpT. LoadT takes a single byte as a tape ID, and dumpT takes the ID as well as the start and end addresses that will be written out. Now that we've defined an ultra-simple interface with the KIM-1, we need to actually write the assembly code for two standard routines, read and write, and our two custom routines, loadT and dumpT. This code will go into a new KIM-1 subfolder in the existing libsource folder. Each target, like the PET and the Atari and now the KIM-1, has its own subfolder. The CRT0.s file implements program startup logic. This is the most complicated part of the setup, and I basically just did what Wayne did in his SIM1 example. When a program starts, your init function is first called, which in our case sets the program stack pointer, zeroes out BSS memory for you, copies data into place, and then initializes any library code that may need it. It then jumps to your main function, which you supply in your C function. The bulk of the work here in the runtime library was spent in putting together the required read and write functions. They are the functions that do the actual TTY input and output. When you call a function like printf, after it's completed all of its parsing and formatting magic, it's ultimately going to send its output to the write function, which is prototyped to take a C file descriptor, a text buffer, and a count of characters. Your job as the library author is to take those parameters and output that buffer using your machine hardware. My write function takes that buffer and the count and walks through the buffer outputting characters while decrementing the count until the count hits 0, at which point it branches to the done label and returns to the caller. It does the actual work of sending a single character to the TTY by calling the outchar function. We defined that a moment ago in KIM1.inc as a ROM routine at 1EA0. I actually deduced these function entry points by looking at Microsoft's basic interpreter to see what it did. Our read function is essentially a mirror of our write function. It calls the machine language monitor's routine to input a single character, intchar, and then stores that character in the buffer. It decrements the count and continues until the buffer is full or the number of characters is satisfied. With those two functions, the compiler now has everything it needs to implement functions like printf, gets, and all the other console I/O functions. In the file named tape.io, I've placed the code for loading and saving via tape. The loadT function just sets the tape ID and then calls the ROM routine in the KIM monitor for loading from tape. The dumpT routine is marginally more complicated in that it has to set up the start and end addresses in memory before then calling the monitor ROM's dumpT save routine. You'll notice a few shortcuts here for returning either a 0 or a 1. Because the return 0 and return 1 functions actually end with a return from subroutine instruction, if we jump to them directly, the RTS at their end will actually return from our subroutine. It saves you a couple bytes each time you need to return a result like that. The rest of the changes to the compiler are just to add the target. Essentially, I added a new symbol called targetKIM1 to the enumeration of available targets, and then everywhere the target code was evaluated in the code, I added a new case to handle the KIM1 target. But what of the rest of the C runtime library? What if I call clock, for example? Where's it going to get a hardware timer without any knowledge of how the system even keeps time? Well, if you call the C function clock, it will in turn ultimately call the assembly language symbol underscore clock. You must then provide that function in the libsource folder, or you'll get a linker error for unresolved external. And in this way, you can start small and build on it as you go. Take file.io, for example. Although the KIM1 has no provision for file.io natively, my system is equipped with a disk controller and a copy of CODOS extensions for Microsoft Basic. Since it in turn exposes a mechanism for reading and writing to disk files, your next step would be to expose that functionality through your read and write calls by actually looking at and making use of the file descriptor, which I entirely ignored in our implementation. For now, I've added two examples to the samples folder. The first is a simple Hello World application to confirm that console input and output are both working as expected. It prints out Hello World and a welcome string, and then it reads a line of input from the console. This should exercise both our read and our write functions. It also displays back the text that we entered so that I can test backspace and make sure stuff like that works during text entry and so on. The next sample is much more substantial in that it uses heap memory to calculate the prime numbers up to some set limit. The highest we can do with available RAM is about 750,000. And how can we do that on an 8-bit machine? Well, we store our sieve in a packed bit array in memory, and I ignore even numbers so that one byte represents 16 numbers. On the Corsham expansion board, we have 60K of RAM, which equates to something on the order of 48,000 bytes of free memory. That's 16 numbers per byte, that's 768,000. Our sieve needs to be able to get, set, and clear bits in that bit array so that it can keep track of which factors are still potential primes. To that end, I added three macros, where each takes the address of the bit array and the bit index into the array. It then uses the array and the mask to fetch or set the value of an individual bit in the array without disturbing any of its neighbors. This saves us memory by a factor of 16 over a native array of bools in C++. But sadly, CC65 is a pure C compiler. No C++ yet, so no bit array class to make our life simpler. It also has a number of other restrictions, like it doesn't support floating point. You can't mix code and data, so like old school C, you have to declare all your variables at the beginning of a scope block. There's no square root function provided in the CC65 runtime, so I was on my own there as well. I'd like to say I wrote this from scratch, but just like you probably would, I just copied and pasted some code from Stack Overflow and cleaned that up. You notice that the main function is prototyped as void, so there are no arguments passed. Absent any kind of shell or parent process beyond the machine language monitor itself, I suppose arguments wouldn't make a lot of sense here anyway. The next thing we do is to get the square root of the limit. Next, we allocate enough memory to hold our bits at a 16:1 ratio. We print out a banner showing the number of bits and bytes to aid in debugging and then do the actual memory allocation. If it succeeds, we set all the bits to 1, meaning the number represented by each index starts out as potentially prime until it is eliminated. Starting with the number 3, we scan through the array for the next available factor that hasn't yet been crossed off out of the array. When we find one, we start at a square and then walk through the bit array marking off every second instance of the factor, since we know that the even multiples are already non-prime. We then step ahead to the next odd number and repeat, checking to see if it's a surviving factor and so on. When we're done, we count the number of primes so that we can sanity check the results against known totals. We then free the memory and return to the caller, which will ultimately fire a break instruction and take us back to the monitor. To test it, I use the S-Record toolkit to create a paper tape file and load that into memory. That process is a little slow and painful, so if you want to see it live in action, check out my video where I run Microsoft Basic on the KIM1, where I show that entire paper tape file process in detail. For now, though, I've got the sieve loaded up at 2000 hex. I enter that address into the monitor, and I press G, at which point it runs the application. The app prints our banner, reports it is working on 100,000 primes, and it says it's using a square root of 316, all of which seems correct. It tells us that it had to allocate 6,250 bytes to hold those 100,000 slots, and checking the math, 6,250 times 16 is 100,000, so it has indeed allocated the precise number of bits required. I've tested 500,000 as well, and if nothing else, that confirms that malloc can still access a large sequential memory block when needed. About a second later, we get our result. I know that 9,394 plots out approximately right for the number of primes up to 100,000, but I think it's actually off by a little bit. It was perfect for 10,000, which I had just checked before recording, however, so there may be a sign extension bug somewhere. Big kudos to anybody who can spot the bug and call it out in the comments. So how fast is 1 second? Well, in Microsoft Basic, the fastest I could ever achieve on the same processor was 6 seconds for the primes up to 1,000. This is doing several orders of magnitude more work, and it's completing it within 1 second, so it's no exaggeration to say that the C version is massively faster than the Basic version. It's not even close. It also compares favorably to the pure assembly language version that can be found in the Language Racing project. By the way, if you've never seen the Language Racing series, be sure to check it out next. We port this Prime Sieve to more than 70 other languages from Ada to Zig, and we rank their performance while touring the languages. And there you have it. Assuming that they want it, I'll contribute these changes back to the master CC65 repo shortly. Until then, you can find it as a repo at Plummer Software LLC, right alongside the Language Drag Racing Prime Number Series, Night Driver, and other cool source code projects from this channel. As always, thanks to Rutger for his hard work in acting as code czar and in maintaining sanity in our source repos, even when I break the build myself now and then. If along the way you've found today's episode to be any combination of entertaining or informative, or if you'd like to see the upcoming NSA key episode, I'd be honored if you consider leaving it a like and subscribing to my channel. If you have any interest in matters related to autism, Asperger's, or ASD, please check out my book on Amazon, Secrets of the Autistic Millionaire. It's got nothing to do with money and everything to do with living a successful life on the spectrum. It's everything I know now that I wish I'd known back then. Remember, I'm mostly in this for the subs and likes, so please be sure to leave me one of each before you go today. In the meantime and in between time, I hope to see you next time, right here in Dave's Garage.
Do it, Glenn! Do it!